Welcome to the next in our online conversation series. My name is Paula Gooder and I'm the Canon Chancellor here at St Paul's Cathedral, which means that I look after theology and learning within the cathedral. Today's conversation is with the Right Reverend Lusa Nsenga-Ngoy, who is the new Bishop of Willesden. Our conversation, as always, ranged widely. We began thinking about the resurrection and its importance to us, but we also thought about Holy Saturday, about prayer and contemplation, and particularly how prayer and contemplation not only informs us as Christians, but sends us out to act as people passionate about social justice. I hope you enjoy this conversation as much as I enjoyed having it with Bishop Lusa. Lusa, it's great to have you with us and to talk about Easter and resurrection and all things hopeful. So it feels like a good place to begin to ask you whether you've got a favourite Easter story.
Well, I presume you're asking an Easter story from Scripture itself.
Yes, or wherever you like, but let's start with Scripture.
I think one of my favorite Easter narrative is the visit of the women to the tomb and that encounter between Jesus and Mary Magdalene. And the very exchange that they have where Mary is referred to by name. And that, I think, resonated quite deeply with me, not least because it's a question around identity and the way in which we name people. But I come from a culture in which names are really significant and important. And a name is not given to one just as a referential, as a way of identifying them. But a name says something about the destiny and the hopes that are projected into that person. The names that we're given connects us to our heritage and a history of people and a place. But above all, a name is also a way in which we belong to a community. And a person who is called is not just referenced, but also invited to be part of the world, the realm of the living. And once your name stops being called, that signifies death and oblivion in many ways. And so hearing that narrative of Mary being named in that place where resurrection happened, in some ways it's an invitation for her to enter the realm of the living and to be named as one who is connected, one who belongs, one who is in relationship. And so that bit of the Easter narrative is one that is quite dear to me.
Thank you. I love that one as well. And I think if there was any part of resurrection stories that make me want to cry every year, it's that moment when you hear Jesus say Mary's name and Mary recognizes who Jesus is. And there was something really powerful about that. So resurrection is a really important idea, both in the scriptures, but actually for the world that we live in today. Can you talk to us a little bit about why, for you, resurrection is a really important part of our life today and why that it feeds your faith as a Christian?
I really like the idea that resurrection is important, not just for the scriptures, but actually it is embedded and rooted in the way we live our life. And I think it is true for the whole of Scripture. We can sometimes read it as a distant document that is lifeless, but there is some beauty in trying to read our stories into the story of faith or to enable the story of faith to read our own story. And so for me, resurrection speaks of hope, speaks of opportunity, speaks of novelty, speaks of creation or recreation. And most recently, my personal experience of resurrection, you may not be surprised, has been somehow linked and weaved around some of the issues and narratives around social justice and racial justice in particular. The wake of the murder of George Floyd, I think myself and many other Black and brown people around the world felt all the burden and the trauma of racial abuse somehow manifest itself in our lives in a way in which most of us had never anticipated or even imagined. But in that place of pain and suffering, what drove many of us was not just a desire to revert things, but to transform things, to be in a place where we could live lives that would be not fractured, not binary, not polarized, but lives that would be reconciled. And for me, there's been a process through which I've been invited to engage deeply and fully with that very experience of trauma and name it for myself as something that I was carrying within me and that was manifesting in ways that were painful, actually physically painful. And in dwelling and wrestling with the pain of racial injustice, but also wrestling not just with myself or with my people, but seeing others being awakened to that reality and the need of retelling our shared story in ways that curate spaces for brave conversations, but also for a transformed way of relating and living with one another. That I started to see insights or promises of the hope that many of us are looking for. I don't think it's a hope that is yet fully realized, but it's a hope that is certainly taking us into a world where the possibilities are a lot more immediate. And so for me, there is something of that lived reality of resurrection, which is not simply a static narrative that happens in a given context, but it's one that weaves itself into every step, every movement of life in a way that will not leave any of us untouched and unchanged and unmoved. And so my hope and prayer is that as we launch ourselves deeper into the movement of resurrection, that we may be carried by that wave that will take us into a place where as we look back, we will recognize that we've been on a journey of transformation, of healing, of reconciliation and restoration to something of a fuller version and a full expression of our humanity.
Thank you. It sounds as though Holy Saturday, Good Friday and Holy Saturday are as important in your description of resurrection as Easter Day is. Is that right? And how would you kind of express that? I mean, in a way, you've kind of started to touch on that, but that feels quite an important part of your story.
Yes, and I think it's really important when we explore or mark or celebrate Easter to remember that Easter is not a singular event, actually. It's one that is connected, not just in the death of Jesus, but in his life as well. So history, in some ways, is not just a succession of punctuations, but it's a cohesive narrative. And so for me, it is impossible to enter the hope and the joy that Easter carries without recognizing that, or without intentionally journeying through the experience of Good Friday and Holy Saturday. I remember a South African friend and colleague who was commenting a few years ago about the fact that in ministry, in his ministry in South Africa, one of the experiences that puzzled him was how Good Friday was actually the day that mobilized most of his congregation and somehow liberated their imaginative capacity. And as we were reflecting, we commented on the fact that actually for most of them, Good Friday was an echo of their lived experience. They felt held in that place of brokenness, of abuse, of isolation and exclusion, but also recognizing that we actually read or enter the story of Easter, Holy Saturday, and Good Friday from a different vantage point. So we look at that story from the end going backward, And it is important to name that particular vantage point, but also the sense that actually it is important to be able to inhabit that place of brokenness, which is often the echo of most of our reality in life, that place where hope feels inaccessible, where despair feels a lot more immediate, where pain is lived and felt and embodied within our lives and our stories. And again, Holy Saturday for me is perhaps the most honest place that we could be, or I could be. That place where I'm held between pain and hope, between despair and transformation, and a place where I need to recognize in the depth of silence the experience that I've encountered, and where I'm preparing myself to enter a new world. And again, I love the idea of Holy Saturday, of Jesus in the darkness of the tomb, and the darkness of the tomb not being a place of despair, but perhaps like in the poem of creation, the darkness that precedes the emergence of light, which is a creative space out of which everything that is called into being will emerge. And so Holy Saturday for me is a feast that, or a day that we ought to recapture and rediscover as a church, recognizing that there is an invitation for us to name the fracture of the past, the pain of the past, not as a forgotten reality, but one that is still at work in us, but recognizing that it isn't the normative space in which we are called to live in and walk in, and open ourselves to that imaginative power that has got cosmic transformative energy. And as we open ourselves to that, and only there perhaps might we enter truly, fully, honestly into the joy of Easter.
That's really, really helpful. How do you do it? Because I think one of the things that I'm really kind of struck with when you're talking is kind of the power of that emotion of the being in the pits of despair and feeling as though there is hopelessness all around you. And yet, Gary, you so beautifully articulate being kind of drawn into resurrection life. And I'm just wondering how you do it personally, because I know a lot of us through various recent events have felt absolutely gripped by despair. And at those moments, it can be really hard to hold on to resurrection, can't it? Because it can feel as though you're entirely Good Friday and nowhere near Easter Day. Do you have anything that you do in those times that reminds you of the Easter moments?
Well, I think for me, it's remembering that hope is a practice. Again, I've spoken earlier about the fact that it isn't just about events. It's not just about moments, but it's about movement. And so for me, there is something about developing spiritual practices that enable me not to enter into a space of escapism. And I think in my early years in faith, and perhaps in ministry even, there was a temptation to kind of throw myself into a positivism or positivist vision of faith and vision of the world. But the more I experience the reality of life and my own reality, the more I'm invited, or the more I discover the beauty of, I think, what the ancient called equanimity, that invitation to kind of wrestle and inhabit and enter, lean into the discomfort of life. And as we and as I lean into the discomfort, in many ways I stop fighting and struggling with it, or try to explain it away, or write it out of my narrative, but fully enable it to be part of my story, of my life. And in the process of naming it, I also need to remind myself of the fact that discomfort, disruption are also part of a movement that inevitably will take me to what I often refer to as a place of dislocation. And dislocation not in being dismembered, but where I am taken from one place, one expression, one embodiment into another one. And it becomes, therefore, not just a leaping from one moment to another, but a movement in which the whole of my life becomes part of a unified and a cohesive narrative, one that enables me to both name the pain, but also anticipate the hope. And I guess in Ignatian spirituality, they would talk about the desolation and consolation. And so for me, there is something about creating a space where those realities of life are constantly present in me, but not present in a way that that threaten life and chokes life within me, but that somehow release me, unwrap me, and unravel me into a new expression and a new vision of who I am, and who I hope and aspire to be.
And that leads us really well, I think, onto my next question, which is about your passion for social justice. One of the things that is a real marker about the things that you've done in the past are that you have fought in so very many different ways for social justice. And it feels as though you were talking about making things a part of a whole, and it feels as though this is why you get your passion for social justice. Would you like to talk about that a little bit?
Yes. I wonder whether sometimes the environment in which we live and the voices that we invite to speak into our lives in some ways start shaping and framing our own perspective on the world, on ourselves. And I think for me, growing up as a young African boy in Europe, and wrestling with questions about my identity, but also my place and my purpose in a society that often was predicated on the assumption that I would not fully belong. Those steps and journeys in my life caused me to consider the world not in a way that enables me to be satisfied with status quo, but have that constant dissatisfaction with the world as it was not while I anticipated or imagined that it could be much more than that. And I think in the process of engaging with some of those questions and conversations that initially were very self-interested and self-concerned, progressively recognizing that actually I am part of a fellowship of the wounded and the broken. And in that process, becoming attentive to the groans that I hear around me. And I guess the challenge is how do we pay attention to the groans around us without enabling them to somehow deafen us to anything else and to become oppressive? And so for me, it's been an awakening to some of the fractures that people inhabited and the fault lines in our society. And I think it's, I can't remember whether it's Isaiah, or Ezekiel, I think, the prophet who talks about God seeking people who would stand in the gap on behalf of the fractures of the world. And for me, it feels like a calling that is directed to me as an individual, the sense that there is an opportunity for me as I encounter some of the fractures of life, not just to be a spectator or even a distant critique And I find that tension quite difficult, because it is quite easy for me to sit at the back behind a keyboard and be a sort of virtual activist. And so for me, it is out of that sense of a compelling vision of a future that could be radically different, less polarized, less fragmented, a lot more reconciled, a lot more enabling all the fullness of each of our humanity to flourish, that I feel drawn into some of those spaces and offer my voice, not always from a place of a victim of a marginalized and minoritized group, but often recognizing that from my own place of privilege, I need to be the one speaking into that compelling vision of the future, and inviting others to join in and labor to curate that space and that world where true justice can be experienced by all.
And what are the issues that are particularly close to your heart at the moment? I know that through your ministry, there have been particular issues that you have fought for in terms of social justice. Are there any that are particularly important to you right now?
Yeah, I mean, one that I'm actively involved in is issues around gender-based violence, and more specifically, working at attending to the needs of girls and women, and our work with an organization called called Making Her Story, which is really committed to tackle gender-based violence, but also to address some of the structural issues and the systemic issues around gender-based violence. I'm also actively involved in an organization called Initiative of Change, which has got Christian roots in its identity, and works from the principle that global transformation and change starts with a commitment to change and transform oneself. And out of that desire and commitment to work on self, we actively and intentionally partner with others in building bridges across whatever divides we encounter. And so that organization has got a UK base, but it also has a global resonance to it.
Thank you. That's both of them sound quite amazing. Now, you're moving into a new role. You are now the Bishop of Willesden, but your previous role was in Leicester. And I know that you were very involved in Leicester with a new monastic community involving young people, which is known as being a house of prayer. And I was wondering if you'd like to tell us a little bit about it, because it sounds quite an inspiring organisation.
Yes, well, I was fortunate to be connected or married to the right woman. So my wife had trained in the London Centre for Spirituality as a spiritual director. And as we're moving to Leicester, the one person she knew was the person invited to be the prior of the then only dreamed of a new monastic community. And so when we arrived, we were invited to be part of a small group that would work at designing, at giving birthing that community. And so it was a wonderful season in our life. And particularly as we came with a role that did not necessarily attach us to a particular worshiping community. So that became in many ways our worshiping community, our support network. And it was really powerful to be part of a community that was wholly committed to prayer and service. And so enter and share with them a rhythm of life built around a rule of life framed around particular values that were close to our hearts at a personal level, but also be invited into embracing values that others had been carrying, and therefore expanding our charism as individuals, but also as a community. And progressively, that community started to take life and be shaped up. And 4 or 5 years forward, that community now gathers a vibrant group of young adults who are spending a year exploring their own sense of calling and purpose in life and in ministry, and actively serving various church communities, but also committed to holding the diocese and the world indeed in prayer. And it's wonderful to still be part of that community. And even as we prepare to move away from Leicester, we remain part of that community, and we'll continue to join in with them at the distance in the cycles of prayer, but also in the commitments to attend to the rule of life that we subscribe to together.
To hear about prayer alongside kind of the activism that we were talking about earlier. Can you talk to us a little bit about why prayer and activism go so well together for you? It seems as though those are your kind of your twin engines that kind of fire you. Can you talk to us a little bit about that and why prayer kind of inspires you in that kind of way?
Mm-hmm. See, when I first started studying theology, I was in my late teens and early 20s. And I was drawn to liberation theologians, and I was really inspired and enthused by their call to practice and to action. And that was initially, I think, my favorite posture into life and in ministry. But further on, I realized that actually many of the people who've been actively involved in transforming the world, transforming their communities, did so not from a posture of action first, but really deeply rooted in contemplation. And it's something that doesn't really work with my temperament. I find contemplation a challenging exercise. And yet I find that a discipline that is vital. Because one, it repositioned me. I was talking earlier about dislocation, and I think prayer is one of those activities that does not leave us unmoved. And so prayer, for me, has been really vital in enabling me to be dislocated, transported from places of deep self conviction into places where my conviction emanates not from a rational or conceptual notions, but really out of a relational space and relational place. And so prayer for me is less about getting a series of requests answered, but it's really about a posturing exercise. How do I open myself to the world in a way that is honest, in a way that is open? How do I offer myself to God in a way that enables God to move in me and to move through me? And so prayer, therefore, becomes, as you beautifully put, the engine that I think spurs me into action. It becomes the basis, I guess, the rootedness for me in the essence of who I believe God is calling me to be. And it becomes a process through which I am constantly called to examine and re-examine my intention, my aspirations, but also the way in which I enter and engage with others.
That's lovely to hear and really, really inspiring. I know that some people struggle with prayer. And I used to have a friend who would say to me, I watch people praying and I've no idea what they're doing. And I wish I knew what they were doing because I'd like to do it. And I wonder whether if you were to speak to my friend, what would you say to her? How would you encourage somebody for whom prayer is feels like an impossibility, that it just, it's a language. She used to say that it was when she was young, she missed French for a week in school. And when she got back, everyone seemed to know what they were doing and she never picked it up because it always felt like it had kind of gone ahead. And for her, prayer was like that. Yeah. And I wonder what you would say to people who would say, well, prayer just feels like a language that some people know and I don't know it. How would you kind of encourage them?
I think that's a beautiful and wise analogy. I sometimes wonder whether part of the challenge, and I've been there myself, part of the challenge is that prayer becomes a performative task and a performative exercise where we want to quantify prayer and assume that actually prayer is the output and therefore there should be some outcomes that come out of it. That need to look like this, and feel like this, and that. And I wonder whether actually, if we move away from the sense of prayer as a performative act, but prayer being more, I think, something that fits within the rhythm of who we are. And I mean, I grew up speaking French, so I think anyone should spend a bit of time attending to learning French and speaking French. Life would be a lot easier if the whole world spoke French, maybe not. So, if language is an analogy that we want to use, so the point of language is not about memorizing grammar. It's not about gathering, accumulating vocabulary. The point of language is communication, is relationship. And so prayer is a vehicle that enables us to enter in relationship with ourselves, with the neighbor, with, I think, the whole of creation, and with God. And it's something that I'm learning to develop myself. So how... how does prayer fit into my life in relation, for instance, to some of the environmental emergency conversations and questions that we are facing? And so prayer for me becomes not just, again, a specific moment, but it becomes a posture that I take into life. It's a lens through which I'm invited to read my own story and read the story of the world. I can't remember who said that, but I always found that quite liberating, the sense that prayer is not about changing the heart of God, but prayer often changes the heart of the one who prays. And so the encouragement that I would give her is to say, actually, don't try to run a marathon before you can walk. And don't see prayer as a performative exercise that gives you a few, points onto a particular league. But prayer becomes a posture that you take into life, and it's a posture both that is relational in essence, and that is transformative in expression and in experience.
That's fabulous advice. I'm sure she'll love it. I'd like to end by asking you what gives you hope. In a way, you've answered that all the way through our conversation today. But I wondered if there was anything in particular that you'd like to draw our attention to as looking out at the world, which can feel overwhelming and hard, and that the battles we fought in the past, you have to fight again and again. It can feel very dispiriting, can't it? But what gives you hope at the moment?
Yeah. You're right in the sense that despair sometimes seems to be the overarching narrative that we are confronted with, whether it's in geopolitical questions, whether it's on issues around environment. And for me, in this new role that I'm taking on as a bishop within the church, I recognize some of the existential anxieties that we're carrying as an institution. And all of that has got the capacity of eroding hope. And in some ways, in eroding hope, rob us of a real sense of joy in life. And I wonder whether there's also a point there of distinguishing between kind of happiness and joy, and happiness being very circumstantial, happiness being exuberance, being excessive at times, and always punctual. But joy instead is rooted in the essence of who we are called to be. And joy is taking us to a place of contentment. And contentment, I think, birth a sense of life that is less preoccupied with hoarding whatever it is that we are wanting to hoard, but is taking us into a place that is deeply collective and built around community, around compassion, around the need to partner rather than enter in competition. And so what perhaps fills me with hope is to encounter stories of people, sometimes public stories and sometimes private stories, of people who've made a choice and a commitment to be what Desmond Tutu used to call prisoners of hope, who aren't driven by existential anxieties that create polarities and tensions and competition, but people who are truly committed to see the divine in the other and enable that divine to flourish. People who are committed to not be drowned by pain and suffering, but in the silence of Holy Saturday, are readying themselves to burst out open into a new world, a new creation, a new order of things, where life is as it ought to be. I think I find hope in the energy that we collectively commit in attending to the fractures of the past, not wanting to kind of erase them, but redress them. And hope in those places where we're not just committed about creating safe spaces, but brave spaces, where we have those difficult conversations, where we enable lament to be heard, and lament to take us to a place of repentance, reparation, and ultimately reconciliation. That gives me hope, that feeds my hope, and that energizes me to labor and work towards the emergence and the full realization of hope.
Lusa, thank you so much. We started talking about Easter stories and you said, did I want to have a scriptural story or another kind of Easter story? Feels like we began with scripture and ended with a modern day life. So it's been wonderful talking to you, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Paula.